faith, you will reign over all the earth. Let's sing this believer.
Let's sing your name.
offer today. Just as Job said that those very words, and he said, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. And he gives and he takes away. But I choose to say, blessed be your name, Lord. We have a new song we're going to introduce. So listen and sing along.
Of the Lord. He tore the veil and made a way, and the way is to the throne room. The way is to stand before the throne of God, go before Him. And if you close your eyes this morning and just imagine what it'll be like when we're actually there, but spiritually, in the spirit realm, the world that's unseen, the Lord invites us to stand before His throne, even this morning. And the new song they sang, simple phrase, but it said, after all, You are only good. And when you think about after all, whatever your life experiences have been, whatever age you find yourself, or whatever's in your past and in your history, you may have gone up and down and sideways with the Lord and wondered, does He love me? Does He not? Am I okay? Am I not? And after all, I just love that concept. After all of that, I found that it's true. He is only good. What does that mean? Well, is there anything in God that's bad? Is there anything in our Father, our Heavenly Father, that's evil? Is there anything in our Heavenly Father that's anything but good? Everything He does is redemptive. Everything He does in our lives, He's bringing about redemption. If it's pruning, if it's conviction, if it feels like punishment, after all, He's only good. He's bringing about redemption. The redemption of our souls, the redemption of our bodies, the redemption of our lives. So, Father, we stand this morning. You tore the veil. Lord, may we see that. The Bible tells us that we can have visions, dream dreams, and see visions. And Lord, I pray for a vision, Lord, in our mind, in our spirit, that we see ourselves standing right before You and looking into Your eyes and seeing only good, seeing such compassion and such love that You have for us. Thank you, Lord, for Your love for us. Thank You for Your compassion. Thank You for doing a redeeming work in our lives. Thank You that all things work together for good to us who trust You, who love You, who rely on You, who cling to You, who believe in You. Lord, I pray this morning for Family Worship Center, Lord, that You continue to make everything that is happening in this church, in this building, and in the lives of the people that come here, make it all, Father, work together for good. May we see, Lord, Your redemptive hand in everything that's happening. Father, thank You. Thank You for all of it, Lord. Thank You, Lord. Thank You for all of it, Father, because we trust You. We trust You. You're our King. You're our Lord. We bow before You this morning. Oh, Lord God, anyone that's here this morning, that sick, suffering, tormented, Lord, we speak healing, release, deliverance, peace, joy. Thank You, Father, for visiting us. Even in the nighttime, when we wake up and Your presence is with us, thank You for being with us, Lord. Never alone. You've never left us or forsaken us. You're always with us. Lord, thank You. Thank You, Father. Again, thank You for provision. Lord, thank You. All of us here have more than we need. Food, shelter, clothing, abundance. Lord, thank you for providing. And Lord, as we prepare to give back to you from what you've given us, Lord, we just want to say to you, thank you. Thank you that you're a good, good Father. And as the gentlemen come forward, you may be seated.
I want to speak to you out of the book of Mark, the fourth chapter, and I'll begin reading at the 35th verse. Mark 4, 35. On the same day when evening had come, he said to them, "Let us cross over to the other side." And when they had left the multitude, they took him along in the boat as he was, and other little boats were also with him. And a great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat, so that it was already filling with water. But he was in the stern, asleep on a pillow, and they awoke him and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we perish?" And he arose and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace be still." And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. And he said to them, "Why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith?" And they feared exceedingly and said to one another, "Who can this be that even the wind and the sea obey him?" I've pictured that in my mind as often as I've read this scripture and preached about it and heard preaching about it. The windstorm was very devastating, and a preacher friend of mine, I heard him preaching on this as well, and he said he arose and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace be still." I've heard choirs sing this song, "The wind and the waves will obey thy will, peace be still." They bring it down quietly. And this preacher that I was talking to, and I kind of identified with him, he said, Jesus didn't say, "Peace be still." He said, "Be quiet, and I don't want to hear from you again." I don't know which is true. I like to think that's what he did. But he did bring calm to that troubled time. And I want you to know today that Jesus still calms storms in your life. It's been a very busy day. And Jesus was very busy. He was accustomed to busy days. Every day he rose up early in the morning, the Bible said, for prayer. Did you ever think about that? Jesus, the Son of God, the incarnate Christ, prayed every day, every morning. And he prayed for direction, and he prayed for the anointing that he would need from the Father to strengthen him in his ministry. He was very busy about the Father's business. He said that when he was 12 years old to his mother, "Would you not that I be about my Father's business?" And on this day he had preached to multitudes. The Bible declares there was thousands of people. And the teaching and the preaching began by the seaside. And as he preached, more and more people came to hear him. And I'm sure it was a very diverse crowd. It always is. Skeptics, the critics, the thrill seekers, those who are looking for another free lunch, the indifferent, and also the needy, the lost needing to be found, and the found needing to be directed and strengthened in their walk. It was a very diverse crowd that he was speaking to. And those who came to be found were always found. They were always saved. Those who came to be fed were always fed. And those who came for other reasons were always disappointed. The critics came. Jesus surrounded by critics many, many times. And the size of the crowd forced Jesus to get into a boat and preach from the boat. The crowd sat on the seashore. I've been to that spot in Israel several times where tradition says this happened, the northern shore of the Sea of Galilee. The crowd sat, were on the seashore. And if you know anything about echo from when you, it seems like the water amplifies voices. And you could be on this side of a lake, and people over on the other side are just talking normally, but you could hear it. It carries across. I know you've experienced that. Well, Jesus went out on the water to preach to them, and they sat on the shore and listened. Jesus generally taught in parables. A parable is an illustrated lesson. This time he was speaking about the parable of the sower. And it was illustrated in this very crowd that he's talking to. He was teaching them, and he's talking about the seed that fell by the wayside, that was cast aside by the hearer, the seed that fell on stony ground. In other words, they made a mental ascent to what he said, but it didn't change their heart. There was no depth. It was quickly laid aside, kind of like an emotional kick you get at a revival service that lasts for a short time. Others fell among thorns. They hear the word, and their appetite isn't such that they desire more. The cares of life, greed, wrong priorities destroy the life of the seed. And then others fell on good ground. In my life, since I've understood the word of God as a kid, grew up in church, it was mandatory. Church was mandatory for us. How many was raised like that, where you went to church and that you had to go? And heard the word preached so many times, and it edified me, it strengthened me until this day. I've tried to be good ground for the word to come in and grow. Ground that produces fruit. The word took root and changes were made in some of these people's lives. That's the quick overview of the parable of the sower. Now even had come, even time, night time, and it was time to go home, get some supper, and get some sleep. In Jesus' case, it was a well-deserved sleep. I can almost hear the Peter saying, "Lord, we passed a really nice inn down here. Can we go there and spend the night in that inn?" But Jesus insisted that they travel at night. He wanted to be busy about the Father's business. And he said, "Let's go over to the other side." I wonder why Jesus wanted to travel at night. I think he was still motivated by his words to his mother. "I'm here to do my Father's business. That's my focus. There's hurting people over on the other side of this lake that need the word. They're lost souls. I've come for them." And so there's a work to do. And nothing kept Jesus from his mission. That hasn't changed, by the way, over the years. The command was obeyed at once. The Bible says they took him as he was into the ship, and they headed off into the night, much against the advice of those who were well learned on the Sea of Galilee and the dangers that was there. But they were headed for a night of trouble. It was not unusual then or now for sudden storms that come up in the Sea of Galilee. And the many times that I've been on that sea in our Israel trips, the guide always explains why it could be very placid and all of a sudden a storm will come. There's a channel, it's not a channel, but there's a valley that goes from the north end of the Sea of Galilee straight to the Mediterranean Sea. It's like a funnel. And storms come rolling in from the Mediterranean and they encompass the Sea of Galilee. It happens very quickly, and it was not unusual, it was very usual. And the storm came. His command to face storms today still resonates with me. In Job chapter 14, and verse 1, it says, "Man that is born of woman is a few days and full of troubles." So sometimes you find yourself in the teeth of a storm. The last few weeks we've learned as much about storms as we ever want to learn, from the hurricanes that have devastated so much property and so many people. But he came to them on the storm. He sent them out into the storm, and then he came to them on the storm. And I just want to remind you, Christian, child of God, Hebrews 13:5 says, "I will never leave you or forsake you." I will never leave you or forsake you. He say amen to that? I mean, that's an awesome promise. No matter what you're going through, he's there. I've been in situations where I'm sure glad I knew that verse, that he was there, because it didn't look very bright. He'll come to you. You will have storms and troubles, but you're not alone. He said, "I will come to you in the storm." I've been fascinated by a hidden truth in this scripture, verse 36, the last part of the verse. It's a sentence that speaks volumes to me. It says, "And there were with them other little ships." I preached a whole sermon on that years ago about the other little ships. There was others that were following the boat that Jesus was in, and they wanted to get to the other side as well to hear him preach over there. And so there were with him other little ships. I don't know how many, maybe a whole flotilla or what, but might have been three or four. But for some reason or other, the Holy Spirit chose to put that sentence in this scripture. "And there were with them other little ships." It doesn't say how many. It just says other little ships. Others who wanted to hear. Others who wanted to experience Jesus. Others who were saying, "I want to be where Jesus is." I don't know if they asked him permission, "Lord, take us with you," or they just followed. I believe they just followed. But this is the truth that jumped out to me. And so I want you to think about this. Others were experiencing the same storms that the disciples were experiencing. Others are experiencing the same troubles and pressures and heartaches, storms that you're going through in your life. Don't ever forget that. There are others that may be depending on you, on your stability, on your faith, to help them through the storm. These other little ships didn't have Jesus in their boat. Jesus was in the disciples' boat, but they faced the same fears and the same danger. A couple truths here, several important truths for your edification and mine. Number one, he stilled the storm for all of them. Think about this. When you're going through a hard time, others around you are going through sometimes the same kind of a struggle, and how you handle that. You could help them or hurt them. It's important that we realize that our lives reflect our faith and our confidence in Jesus Christ. Let others be blessed by your stability in the Lord, by your faith. An old hymn in our hymn book says, I'm anchored in Jesus. The storms of life I'll brave. I've anchored in Jesus. I fear no wind or wave. I've anchored in Jesus, for he has power to save. I've anchored to the rock of ages. These other little chips were experiencing the same storm and the same fears, and yet they were, when Jesus calmed the storm, it affected them all. The truth there is this. Point one, he stilled the storm for all of them. If you hear nothing else today, this is a big lesson for you and for me. When you have victory in your life, others are affected. You can be a positive influence wherever you go. In church or at work, in the marketplace, and whatever you do, if you have victory in your life, it affects other little ships. Think about that. And if you believe me, say amen. It does. It really does. People are looking to you for encouragement. Many times at work, something will go wrong, and how you react. And I've said often, it's not your actions, it's your reactions that indicate what's inside of you when the troubles come. When you get squeezed against the wall, so to speak, does Jesus ooze out of you? When you go against a hard time, or you're persecuted, or you're wronged by somebody, don't let that come out of you in any negative way. Remember, you're surrounded by other little ships, people that need your faith. When you have a defeat in your life, and you will, if you haven't, you will. How you handle that can affect others. That's why those of us who profess Christ must weather the storms victoriously. We must. If we're reflecting Jesus, let's reflect him, be an object, a person that people can lean on, and a reflection of his perfection. Other little ships are affected. The influence of a Christ-centered life will affect the other little ships. There are little ships, and I can even... And I reflect here I'm thinking about children that are watching your life. And how you act and react, people are being influenced. They may be mature people, yet their children spiritually. They're influenced by what they see and what they hear. So be careful. Oh, be careful, little eyes, what you see. I mean, we sang that song. Be careful, little hands, what you do. There's your father up above. I mean, know that song? You ever sing it as a kid? It's a good lesson. Be careful. Other ships are watching you. People will learn how to worship or how not to worship by watching their parents. Children will see. And I hope you realize that in church, that how you react to the ministry of the Word and the anointing of the Spirit and the drawing of the Holy Spirit affects your children. Your honesty reflects in your children as well. You have to be careful about that. I remember hearing a testimony of a young man who got himself in trouble with Uncle Sam. And that's not hard to do. But he was copying what he saw his father do in Texas. And he cheated. And he got caught. But he learned that from his father. Other little chips are affected negatively by watching their parents. They'll learn how to tithe or not to tithe by watching their parents. They learn how to react to pressures and troubles and sickness. They'll learn how to be honest or not to be honest. Baby Christians of every age are affected by watching others. They'll watch your church attendance, your consistent life, your actions, your reactions, and they'll be affected. I don't want to be like the shoes or be in the shoes of a mature Christian who destroys a baby Christian by their lack of commitment with slander or gossip or criticism. Gossip is a terrible thing, is it not? Proverbs, I believe it's chapter 6, 16 maybe. The Bible says, these six things the Lord hates. Yea, seven are an abomination to him. He had thought of another one, see? And several of those things have to do with gossip, bearing a false report, pulling somebody down by the way you talk about them. So be careful. Other little ships are affected by your reactions. I do not want to be a negative influence on baby Christians. We that profess to have Christ in the boat are surrounded by other little ships. Don't ever forget that. And we're responsible. Another truth here is this. It pays to serve Jesus. Storms come, rain falls, wind blows, devastating winds sometimes. And when you have the master pilot in control, you'll make it through. Always give him the honor of being the one who steers the ship. I remember years ago hearing Tennessee Ernie Ford. I love his voice, by the way. Jesus Savior, pilot me. Does that sound like Tennessee Ernie? Sounds like his grandmother, right? But that's a great song. Over life's tempestuous sea, unknown waves before me roll, hiding rocks and treacherous soul, but chart and compass come from thee. Jesus Savior, pilot me. When I was studying this week, and what triggered me in this thought was the last week and a half or so, maybe 2 weeks, of the storms that devastated the islands. The Bahama Islands were wiped out, millions, maybe billions of dollars of damage. They were hit. The sea was, that part of the world, the Caribbean Sea, was devastated by unexpected storms. And I got praying about that and thinking about that. How do I react when I go through a storm? Verse 37 says, the waves beat into the ship. The waves beat into the ship. In other words, your enemy will try to put you under. Satan will do his best to destroy you, to fill your life with problems and heartaches and reverses. And it has a tendency to choke you spiritually. But the master, if he's in your boat, keep the master in your boat. If he's in your boat, you keep his name in your house. Speak often to him and about him. You will not go under. Second Chronicles, there's a beautiful story where and I won't get into too much because of time, but the enemy was coming hard. And so the prophet prayed to Jesus, poured out his heart, and he said, I don't know what to do, God. That was the words. I don't know what to do, but my eyes are on you, and your name is in this house. It's in there, 2 Chronicles, I think, verse chapter 20. But your name is in this house. That's a challenge to the Lord. Lord, I'm following you, I'm serving you, I'm trusting you. I don't know what to do, but your name is in this house. And I encourage you today, through the storms that you're going to go through, many of you have been through storms. The devil's doing his best to destroy marriages, to destroy churches. But if you keep the master in your boat, keep his name in your house, speak to him often, speak about him often, and you will not go under. You'll be a testimony to other little ships that are watching your life if you keep him first. One other thing about this that I noticed when I studied it, Jesus was sleeping. Did Jesus sleep? Yeah. He was God in the flesh. And my flesh gets tired and I sleep once in a while. I love to sleep, do you? But Jesus was sleeping. But he was sleeping at an interesting spot. The Bible says he was near the helm. He was sleeping, but he was in the pilot's place. He was in charge, even though he was sleeping. And that tells me that God is only a prayer away. He doesn't slumber. He doesn't sleep. He allows storms to come. But he promised me and you that our ship will never be swamped if he's the pilot, if we're allowing him to direct our lives. Glory to God. He was sleeping in the pilot's place. Jesus allows storms to come. But if you trust him, your ship will remain afloat. I love what David says, Psalm 121. He will not suffer your foot to be moved. This is a promise. He that keeps you will not slumber. He'll neither slumber nor sleep. He's your keeper. He's your preserver. Now and evermore, praise God. His physical body slept, but his heart was awake, and the disciples did the right thing. Jesus is sleeping in the back of the boat, and they called him. They didn't try to do it themselves. They called him, and he never minds when you call him. No matter what you go, he never says, well, why'd you wait so long? I mean, no, you call on him in a time of trouble. He's your first line of defense and offense. Don't ever say, like one man said, I came to my last resort, I decided I better pray. No, pray before that. Pray sooner. Jesus' physical body slept, but his heart was awake. And his disciples did the right thing. They called him. They didn't try to do it themselves. You'll learn. As you grow in God, you will learn. And I'm learning all the time. Now that I passed my teenage years, I think sometimes, wow, where did the time go? Do you ever think that way? I mean, look back and before you know it, you're a... But life's exciting with Jesus. They called him. They didn't try to do it on their own like I have tried. You'll learn as you grow. With Christ in the boat. It might be tossed. You might go through some hard times, some scary times, some panic times. Jesus, help me. But your boat will not sink if he's in the boat with you. He's always attentive to the prayers of his people. Jesus raced to the need, and he has control. Greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. Praise God. Just a reminder of this, and I know you know this. He has dominion over the wind, the rain, the storms, the addictions, the habits, the sickness, the financial pressure. Whatever you need, body, soul, and spirit, he has a supply. He is the answer. Go to him first for deliverance and for answers. Don't try to row your own boat. Let Jesus have control. And he did it with one word, beautiful word. He said, peace, be still. Peace came and calm came in the middle of that storm. Only the Prince of Peace can bring peace. No politician, no White House. Only the Prince of Peace can bring peace. Their fear overcame their faith. And I identify with that. I've been there. I've allowed fear to overtake my faith until the Lord corrected me. And then my faith was built up and I learned to trust him. When faith is weak, I've learned that prayer should be desperate. Did you ever pray a desperate prayer? Desperate and strong? Because you're in a spiritual battle. But don't crumble in the storm. Go to God as soon as possible. Just another personal illustration. I remember going through a deep, deep, deep valley. And it wasn't for me, it was somebody else that was close to me that they were going to split up. And I was so burdened about that. And I was driving and I was praying, I was crying, I had to pull over off the side of the road because I couldn't see because of the tears in my eyes and the burden that I was carrying for them. I pulled off alongside the road and I poured out my heart to God, and he visited me there in my car and he brought peace to my heart. But it took desperate prayer. I need you, God. That's why I don't believe he said, peace, be still. He said, hey, I'm here, you know. But it did happen. When you put your trust in him to calm the storm, you can say with Matthew, Matthew said they marveled. When you put your trust in him, you'll marvel at his ability. He'll calm your storm quickly and it'll help you trust him more. So because of the other little ships, it's important. And it's my final thought to you today. Because of the other little ships that are watching you, it's important for mature Christians to weather the storm with strong faith and confidence in Christ. New babies need to see example of stability. I want to be that kind of a Christian. With Christ in my boat, steering it. I saw a license plate years ago. They were popular. It said, God is my co-pilot. And I like that. God is my pilot. Don't try to weather the storms on your own. Call on him. You might think he's sleeping, but he's not. And he'll immediately get up to your help or be there for your help. So I'm out of time. But I felt this week as I was praying and reading the reports of the storms that were devastating homes, and I mean really devastating, I thought, you know, I'm thankful that I have someone that knows how to weather the storm. His name is Jesus. Would you stand with me, please? Father, I thank you for your word today. I thank you for the privilege of declaring your truth and of being lifting up your name. And I thank you, Lord, that we realize how important it is that we live an overcoming life because of other little ships that are around us. I thank you for that truth that you showed me this week, that when Jesus calmed the storm for the disciples, it just calmed the storm for all those other little ships as well. Help us to leave here with determination to stand up and be counted for Christ. And bless us throughout this day. The service that follows, let it be anointed with your presence. And let each one of us be your love reflected to our world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you.